Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are and whatever time you are having or observing. This is me, Ahmed, and I welcome you all on the day two of the Practice to Pass webinar for the June 2021 exam session. And we are about to start the day two. And before we start day two, let's quickly recall what's the exam format of this audit and assurance exam. Audit and assurance exam have got two sections, section A, section B. Section A will be having three MTQs, and those three MTQs could be tested from any area of the syllabus. And audit and assurance exam has got a very poor pass percentage globally. And one of the greatest reason or one of the most significant reason of such high failure is that generally speaking, students tend to score very below average marks when it comes to section A. So what you have to do is that you are still left with 39 days or 40 days approximately. You have to spend quality time on your MTQs, six MTQs per day. And keep one thing in mind, if you are investing 45 minutes or 1 hour on the six MTQs, you need to spend equal amount of time on the solution of those MTQs as well. Until or unless you are not going to invest quality time on the solution, you won't be able to clear your little concepts. You should be comfortable with your MTQs. The level of comfort should be of such level that you should be able to make someone understand why statement number one is false, what changes could have been made in the statement number B, and that would have made statement B true. So your preparation should be of such great level. Okay, the section B will be having three long questions. The first long question will be of 30 marks, question number two, 20, and question number three, 20 marks. Okay, as far as the syllabus is concerned, we have got three major areas. The first major area was audit risk, and the audit, we covered audit risk yesterday, and audit risk has got nothing to do with today's lecture. So if someone or if somebody out there did not attend yesterday's class, but he or she is present today, so no problem at all, I welcome you, and you are not going to have any problem whatsoever, because risk has got nothing to do with controls. Today's major agenda is controls. So we have got three major areas: risk, controls, and substantive procedures. We did cover risk yesterday, we will be covering controls today, and we will be focusing on the third and the most painful major area called substantive procedure on tomorrow and day after tomorrow as well. Okay, let's straight away go to the this very extremely important file. Why students tend to fail audit and assurance exam, why F8 has got such a poor pass percentage, especially as compared to your tax, as compared to your financial reporting, or for that matter as compared to your financial management, why audit has got such a high failure rate. In fact, when it comes to professional exams, the highest failure rate in the professional exams is of advanced audit and assurance. So that speaks for itself. Why students fail in audit and assurance exam? Number one reason, audit and assurance requires huge amount of typing. There are 70 marks for typing, and you need to have extraordinary typing speed. You need to practice too many questions, mock exams, under the exam environment. Otherwise, you won't be able to deliver. Otherwise, you won't be able to complete full exam. So you need to invest quality time on your typing speed. That's the first reason of high failure. Second reason, a tax student or an FR student or a PM student or an FM student, that student will be focusing on the section A and section B, the MCQs and the MTQs. But when it comes to audit and assurance, that student will not be bothered about section A. And as a result, that student will not be able to score good enough marks in the section A, and that leads to high failure rate. Number third reason of failure rate being so high is students tend to score nothing or very below average marks when it comes to knowledge base. Yes, the knowledge base will be tested in the section number B, in the section B, and in the section B, approximately out of 70, 15 marks are for the knowledge-based types. Knowledge-based is something which you are either going to perform and you will get full marks, or you are going to get nothing out of it. So you have to invest quality time on the knowledge base. How this is possible? Yes, it is very much possible and convenient. You have to invest 1 hour daily on your knowledge base starting from today. Well, in fact, I hope you did start from yesterday. So knowledge base, 1 hour, and everything will be smooth during the exam. Second last reason, exam techniques. Exam techniques technique is extremely important. I will be emphasizing the exam technique of internal controls in the next half an hour, and you will realize that internal control system is not a difficult topic provided you know the technique. Last but not the least, do not ignore the minor areas of the syllabus. We did cover ethics yesterday. We will cover corporate governance today. So the minor areas are also important. They tend to give you at least 10 marks in the MTQs and 10 marks somewhere in section B. So if you are good at minor areas, it means you are good at 20 marks of the paper. Okay, before I start today's topic, let's summarize the last 15 minutes or last 10 minutes. Let's summarize all that. Just imagine there is a student, let's say his name is Ahmed, and just imagine that student scored 10 out of 15 or 12 out of 15 marks in the knowledge based. So let's say 10 marks out of 15 marks in the knowledge based. Now that student also scored 24 or 25 or 20 or plus marks in the MTQs. So last, now just imagine that score, that student also scored 10 or 15 marks out of the minor areas. So out of 50 marks, that student has already covered 35, 40, 30 plus marks, and 50% paper is yet to be attempted. So what I'm trying to emphasize here is that if you are going to invest quality time on your MTQs, if you are going to invest quality time on your minor areas, and if you are going to pay due respect to your knowledge base, these three things will give you a kick, and that can push you from 47, 46 to 64, 65, not 48 to 52. They can boost your marks to a greater extent. So if you are going to evaluate, or me being the tutor, if I evaluate the failure students or the characteristics of students who pass their exams, I end up concluding these three things, that when it comes to core areas of the syllabus, such as risk, controls, and procedures, generally speaking, everyone is good at it. But when it comes to these minor areas, these knowledge-based areas, and these MTQs, students tend to fumble over there. So you have to pay respect to these three things: MTQs, knowledge-based, and the minor areas. Okay, I told you my plan yesterday. We covered risk and ethics yesterday, and we'll be covering internal controls, internal audit, or corporate governance today. So let's start with the internal controls. Okay, so the major topic number two. The first major topic was audit risk. Let's start the major topic number two, internal control system. Normally speaking, you will get at least 20 plus marks in your exam from this particular topic. It could be 25 or even beyond that, but at least 20 plus marks will be covered through internal control systems by your examiner. Okay, first of all, I would like to highlight what are internal control systems, or what is internal control system. Internal control systems are the policies and procedures. These are the rules and regulations designed by the management in order to make sure that there are no incidents of frauds, there are no incidents of errors. So internal control systems are the policies and procedures designed by the management just to make sure that they can achieve their objectives. They don't wish to be in a spot of bother. They don't want to face a fraudulent activity. They don't wish to experience errors leading to losses. So the internal control systems are designed by the management just to make sure that things are going as smooth as it could be. These are the rules and regulations. These are the do's and don'ts. So one has to purchase a certain thing. That particular individual needs to go to a certain authoritative level and get the authorization. Now, this is an internal control. You want to enter the accounts department, but you don't have access to that because you don't belong from the accounts department. So you won't be allowed to enter there. This is an internal control. When the goods are received from a supplier, one individual, let's say Ahmed evaluates the quantity, But another individual, the quality inspector, also evaluates the quality of it. So this is an internal control system. When the cash is received, it is promptly banked so that cash is not stolen over the night. So this is an internal control. So internal control systems are the policies and procedures, and they are designed by the management, implemented by the management, just to make sure that the instances of frauds and errors are to be minimized or to be avoided. Now, in our syllabus of audit and assurance, there are six internal control systems. Number one, sales system. Number second, purchase system. Number third, inventory system. Number fourth, payroll. Number fifth, bank and cash. Number six, non-current asset system. Now, I would like to highlight a very important and a brave statement over here. You have to listen to it and you have to trust me on that. I absolutely believe on that if you are going to go through one system out of these six systems with the help of a proper trainer, someone who can guide you, one system, all other systems could be handled and prepared by an average student on a self-study basis. All you need is one system with the help of a proper guidance or with the help of a proper trainer. That's it. Because the science or the chemistry of all these systems is more or less same. There is hardly any change in it. The real issue lies in the exam requirements. There are six systems, and I'm saying they all are same to same. So how they are different to each other? They are not different to each other. They are indifferent, but the difference lies in the exam requirements. The examiner tends to change the requirement every now and then. Otherwise, the systems are same to same. In the March 2021 webinar, day two, I covered sales system and payroll system. Today, I'm going to cover purchase system and bank and cash system, a very tricky system. Generally speaking, students hate payroll system and bank and cash system. We covered payroll system in the March 2021 webinar. I can provide you the link of that particular lecture in the WhatsApp group. Don't worry about that. But for today, I'll be covering purchase system and bank and cash system. Okay, I just mentioned that the real trick lies in the exam requirements. As far as the systems are concerned, they are indifferent. All of them are more or less same to same. So the real issue is the exam requirements. So please embrace yourself and please have a look at it. These are the possible exam requirements we have. Nothing more, nothing less. That's it. Here are all the possible exam requirements out of the internal control systems. These are all the exam requirements which have been tested by the audit and assurance examiner, and they will be tested in the future as well. In fact, there are a couple of them, one or two exam requirements, which are more or less mandatory for every attempt. Okay, let's start these exam requirements. Let's explore them one by one. The first requirement is list three or four control objectives of sales system, purchase system, inventory system, bank and cash system. Now, what do I mean by control objectives? If you guys have developed a sales system in your organization, why you have developed a sales system? What's the reason behind developing a sales system? Why you wanted to have a sales system in your organization? Because you wanted to make sure that all the sales are recorded promptly. You wanted to make sure that when goods are dispatched, they are dispatched at the right address to the right customer. You wanted to make sure when goods are dispatched, right quantity is dispatched. You wanted to make sure when invoice is generated, the right amount is allocated to the sales invoice. You wanted to make sure when the sales invoice is generated, you wanted to make sure that only those customers who qualify for the discounts, they tend to or they get to avail the discount. That's it. So these are the objectives of sales system. You want to make sure when it comes to purchase system that only authorized purchases are made. You want to make sure that only business related items are purchased. When it comes to purchase system, you have designed and developed a purchase system because you want to make sure that only purchases are made from the authorized supplier, not from any XYZ or my cousin or my relative. When it comes to purchase system, you want to make sure that purchases are made at the best possible price. You want to make sure that if there is any possibility of early settlement discount when it comes to purchases, you want to avail it if the company is looking forward to it. So these are the objectives of purchase system. And similarly, what could be the objectives of the bank and cash system? I would like to make sure that bank and the cash and the receipts are recorded promptly. They should be banked on a daily basis. They should be secured in a proper safe lock, immovable. I want to make sure that bank reconciliations are performed so that the unreconciled items should be identified and investigated. So these are the objectives of the sales system, purchase system, non-current asset system, inventory system. Obviously, you can go through all these objectives using your study text. Yes, you all are right. You all are thinking right that this control objectives is a knowledge-based requirement. It has got nothing to do with your with your story of the question or with the application side. No, it's a knowledge-based. So I'm hoping out of these five requirements in our screen, we are done with one. I hope you are done with one. And the examiner is never going to exceed control list seven objectives of a control system. No. Three or four, hardly three. I don't think so. The examiner is going to exceed more than three. That's it, three. Okay, let's go to the second requirement. Identify and explain or simply describe. You all are familiar that when it comes to audit and assurance, describe means identify and explain. And you all know half mark is for identification and half mark is for explanation. So I can say describe eight deficiencies in the company's purchase system, or I can say identify and explain eight deficiencies in the company's purchase system. So that's the requirement number two. Now let me explain this requirement a bit more for you. The examiner is going to give you, or the examiner is going to come up with a sales, purchase, bank and cash, or any XYZ system of a company. You as a student are going to go through that system. You are going to read that particular system. And as a student, you are supposed to identify few deficiencies. When it comes to the identification of deficiency, the identification is from the question itself. So you don't need any rocket science for the identification. All you need is the correct eyes or the correct lens to identify the deficiency. I will be teaching you how to identify the deficiency. So you have to identify the deficiency from the question itself. And when you are going to identify eight deficiencies, if the examiner has asked for eight, let's say, or five deficiencies, you will get half mark for each and every identified deficiency. And this is a gift because you don't have to identify from a newspaper. You don't have to identify using Google. You have to identify from one page, and you have to identify the deficiencies from the question itself. So there is no rocket science in it. It is as simple as it could be. So you have to identify the deficiencies from the question. And a very heartwarming news is, when it comes to identification of deficiency, you can always copy that deficiency from the question itself, control C, control V, and you can get half mark for doing nothing basically. So identification of deficiency from the question, but you have to explain that deficiency as well in order to get another half mark. How you are going to explain it? The explanation of deficiency requires you to explain or highlight the negative consequences of that deficiency. After all, it's a deficiency. It can never have positive consequences. A deficiency will always be having negative consequences. So when it comes to explanation, you have to highlight the negative consequences of that deficiency, and that will give you another half mark. Okay, so that's the requirement number two we have, and it's a complete application based requirement. Okay, let's go to the requirement number three. Once you have identified and explained a certain deficiency, the examiner is expecting you to give a suggestion. What do I mean by suggestion? You have to provide recommendations to address deficiencies. What does that mean? Recommendation. Recommendation means against the poor control, against the deficiency, you have to explain a good control. So you have to explain a recommendation. You have to provide a recommendation. What does recommendation means here? A good control. So you have to recommend a good control in order to overcome that particular deficiency which you identified in the first instance. So the deficiency has to be, so that recommendation has to address the deficiency. So if there was a deficiency that the storeroom was not properly monitored or guarded, so your recommendation should be covering or addressing that particular deficiency. So one mark is available for one recommendation, and you are not expected to write two or three recommendations. You are expected to write one recommendation against one deficiency. That's it. If you know a couple of recommendations, if you know three recommendations, hold on, take a moment and write or type the best out of it. Don't try to come up with a couple of recommendations. Don't try to be over smart, because this over smartness will lead you to a situation where you won't be able to complete your full paper, and as a result you are going to express your grief with your tutor that I attempted 90 marks paper and got 48. Okay, fine, we are not sorry, because you are the one who did not attempt the full paper. You should have attempted 100 marks paper, and rather than 48 you could have ended up 54 or at least 50. So stick to the marking scheme. There is one mark for recommendation, write one recommendation, that's it, move on. The fourth exam requirement when it comes to internal control system: identify and explain five key controls. Now, what do I mean by key controls? And let me tell you, this is the most important and tricky requirement we have. This is the current trend. The examiner is going to test this requirement, I'm telling you, in the coming attempt. Identify and explain five key controls. Now, first of all, we need to understand what is meant by identify. We all know identification gives us half mark, and identification is from the question itself. So we are done with identification. Congratulations. Now we have to explain. We had to explain in the requirement number two as well, but that time we had to explain the deficiency. But this time around, we have to explain the key control. Now, what do I mean by key control? Key control is the opposite of deficiency. So if there is a system provided by the examiner to you, there could be few deficiencies and there could be few good controls, the opposite of deficiency. So the examiner is asking you to identify from the question. You need to identify key controls. Then you have to explain as well. How are you going to explain the key controls? How are you going to explain the good controls? Remember, I told you that when it comes to the explanation of deficiency, you have to express the negative side of that system or that deficiency. But when it comes to key controls, you have to highlight the positive side of that control system. You have to express that these are the factors which will help the company. So these are the positive attributes of a system. So the exam requirement number four is an extremely important one. We will be covering this requirement in about half an hour. Identify and explain five key controls. What do I mean by key controls? These are the good controls. What are good controls? These are the controls on which, these are the controls on which I as an auditor would like to place reliance. I would like to place reliance. I would like to, you know, be comfortable with. I would like to say that these controls are operating effectively. So I would like to reduce my substantive testing because the controls are operating very effectively. Okay, the last possible requirement when it comes to internal control system is you have to describe a test of control, not couple of tests of controls, a test of control. What is meant by test of control? A test of control is an action taken by the auditor, not by the client. A test of control is the action performed or executed by the auditor, performed by the auditor in order to verify whether the said controls, whether the controls designed and implemented by the management, obviously the good controls, whether the good controls or the key controls designed and implemented by the management are operating effectively. Should I trust them? I'm not going to trust them blindly. I'm going to evaluate them. First of all, I'm going to test them. Once I'm comfortable, then I can seek my reliance on them. Then I can place reliance on them. So this is called a test of control. I hope this is clear, the exam requirements. Okay, so what kind of exam requirement we should be prepared for the exam? First of all, you should be prepared for all possible exam requirements, full stop. I think there is no pick and choose. We should be prepared for all possible exam requirements. But as far as this exam requirement number one is concerned, this is a knowledge-based requirement, so it is not tested on every attempt. But you have to learn the 4-5 control objectives of all 6 systems, the sales system, the purchase system, the everyone. Okay, so exam requirement number one, I believe maybe. When it comes to exam requirement 2 and 3, what's the exam requirement 2 and 3? One, we have to identify and explain the deficiency, and then we have to provide recommendation. This exam requirement will be examined in every setting. It was tested in March 2021. It will be tested in June 2021. So get ready for that. And we'll be covering a question on that. Don't worry. Okay, is there any possibility that the examiner can ask you to identify and explain a deficiency, provide a recommendation, that is a good control, and then skip the 4th requirement and straight away go to the 5th requirement, that test, provide a test of control to assess whether the recommendation, whether the control you recommended is operating effectively or not. So the examiner can come up with a combination of 2, 3, and 5, explain the deficiency, provide a recommendation, and then test that particular control which you recommended in the previous requirement. So 2, 3, and 5 can be tested as well, probably. And in the recent exams, examiner is testing a combination of 4 and 5. How 4 and 5? The examiner is going to give you a story, and the examiner is going to ask you to identify and explain 5 key controls, the good controls. You have to identify them from the question, and then you have to explain them in your own words, which I will be teaching you today. Then you have to provide a test of control. So this 4 and 5 is a new combination frequently used in the recent papers. We'll be covering each and everything, don't worry. Okay, what about the marking scheme? Identification of deficiency gives you half mark, and the explanation of deficiency gives you another half mark. Straight away jump to requirement number 5. Identification of key control gives you half mark, and the explanation of key control gives you another half mark. And as far as recommendation and the test of controls are concerned, the recommendation, which means suggesting a good control, gives you 1 mark. And when it comes to test of control, it also gives you 1 mark. I hope the marking scheme is relatively easy, and I hope you all are clear with that and excited to be, facing a question. But wait a second, before I move on to the question, before I move on to a past paper question, I would like to help you in identifying the deficiency. These are the exam techniques which I want to teach you. That is how I want to help you. Okay, go back. We need to learn how to identify deficiency. We need to learn how to explain the deficiency, right? And then we need to learn how to come up with recommendation. We need to learn how to write a test of control. We need to learn how to identify key control. We need to learn how to explain key controls. Now, let me teach all this stuff. How to identify deficiencies. Please, my dear students, whatever you are seeing in your screen right now, whatever it is there, this is not an accounting standard. This is not a law or a regulation. This is my observation. This is the data which I've collected from past papers. So there is a possibility there could be another method number 8 of identifying a deficiency. So this is not done and dusted list. This is what I've collected over the period of time. How to identify deficiency? There are half a mark available for identifying the deficiency. How to identify the deficiency? First of all, if you are going to go through a client system, you might realize that one particular individual, let's say Mr. Ahmed, is doing too many interrelated activities. When there are too many interrelated activities performed by one single individual, this is weak segregation of duty. And when there is weak segregation of duty, there are brighter chances of frauds and errors going undetected. So weak segregation of duty or one individual involved in too many activities, it's a potential deficiency in any internal control system. Okay, how to identify deficiency? If an individual is performing a task and that individual is not sufficiently senior enough for that particular task, you are going to highlight this as a deficiency. You are going to say that Ahmed, being clerk, is authorizing the purchases of non-current assets. Ahmed is not sufficiently senior or experienced enough to authorize the purchases of such delicate things, which is non-current assets. As you all know, that non-current assets are significant capital expenditures. They tend to take away the huge sum of money from the company's bank account. So someone senior with more experience and more knowledge should have performed this particular authorization. So if someone not senior enough is performing a task which should ideally be performed by someone senior, you are going to consider or treat it as a deficiency. Number third, I am a purchasing manager, and when I have to make any purchases, I don't need anyone to authorize my purchases. I simply go out and do shopping. So if there is no element of authorization in the exam question, or if there is no element of authorization in the real life when you are evaluating the purchase system of any of your client, if there is no element of authorization, if I'm allowed to entertain new supplier or new customer without any authorization, this is a deficiency. Okay, fourth method of identifying a deficiency. If a work is performed by Ahmed, but no senior individual reviews my work, you are going to elect and you are going to select and you are going to consider it as a deficiency. Just imagine I have performed the bank reconciliation on a monthly basis. That's a company policy. But no one reviews the work performed by me. So when there is no review of work, this is considered as a deficiency. Number five, if I am performing a task manually, but that task could be automated, that task could be delegated to a software, through a computer system, through an IT and IS system, you are going to consider it as a deficiency. Now, just imagine there are two companies, company A, company B. In the company A, the gross wages, the necessary deductions, the calculation of net wages are all performed by manually. Whereas in the company B, there is a software in which you have to just enter the gross wages, which are linked to the bin card or the payroll system. And then all those necessary calculations and deductions and the calculation of net pay is performed through the software. So what do you think? There are brighter chances of human error or fraud when it comes to manual work, but there are relatively 0% chances when the work is automated. Yes, there are chances when it comes to automation as well, but probably if the data is correctly input, there are no chances. Okay, number six, how to identify deficiency. When you are reading an exam question with respect to internal control system, you have to be alert when it comes to the word no or not. Every now and then, examiner is going to facilitate you with a deficiency by expressing, this work is not reviewed by Ahmed. When the goods are received, they are checked for the quantity, but they are not evaluated for the quality. So the word no or not. When the employees, they clock in, when they entered into the factory, the shift workers, they do clock in there, they swipe their cards, but this process is not monitored. So the examiner is going to facilitate you by providing few deficiencies and by highlighting that a certain activity is not performed. So what you have to do is you have to pick it up that considering that this process is not supervised, there could be incidents of frauds or error. So look out for the word no or not in the question. Last but not the least, how to identify deficiency. There are always documentational issues. What are documentational issues? There is a possibility that the purchase orders are not sequentially numbered. There is a possibility that the goods received note are not sent to the ordering department. There is a possibility that the sales invoices are not sequentially numbered, there is a possibility that appropriate signatures are not available on this on a certain document. So these are the documentational issues, and they are other they are extremely important when it comes to deficiencies. So I hope you all are clear with respect to half mark. This particular slide on your screen will earn you 5 to 7 marks on your exam day, 5 marks at least. Okay, half mark, how to identify deficiency. We are done with that, but we need to explain it as well. We need to explain the deficiency so that we can earn another half mark, and overall we can earn one full mark. How to explain the deficiency? You have to explain that if this is not corrected, this could result in, there is a risk that it could lead to loss of future sales. It could lead to loss of customer goodwill. This could result in cash flow problems. There is a risk that this could increase company costs, or it could have negative impact on the business. So when it comes to explaining the deficiency, you need to use words such as this. This could result in, there is a risk that, and how to explain the deficiency? The deficiency could have negative consequences, the negative impact on the business. What kind of negative impact? Number one, it could lead to loss of future sales. It could lead to loss of customer goodwill. It could lead to loss of supplier goodwill. It could lead to cash flow problems. It could lead to increased cost. But how are you going to structure your sentence? You have, remember, you have to copy the deficiency from the question. You have to move to the next sentence, ideally move to the next paragraph, and you have to explain the deficiency. And when it comes to explanation, you might want to start like, this could result in loss of future sales. Now just imagine, let's take a dummy data. Let's say the goods received good dispatch notes are not sequentially numbered. If good dispatch notes are not sequentially numbered, this could result in sales invoices not sent to the relevant customer, and as a result, company could lose future sales. Obviously, the customer is not going to contact you, and they are not going to say, excuse me, we would like to pay you. Once you are not going to send the invoice, they are not going to pay you either. So this is how you are going to explain the deficiency. These are the keywords: loss of future sales, loss of customer or supplier goodwill, cash flow problems, increase in cost, decrease in future, loss of future sales, and how to structure the sentence. This deficiency could result in, there is a risk that, this could lead us to, these are the words which you need to use. Okay, so we are done with requirement number one, two. Let's go to another requirement. How to explain the recommendation. Mind you, the recommendation has got 1 mark. How to explain the recommendation. The recommendation means suggesting a good control. And when it comes to suggesting a good control, you will get 1 mark for that. How to explain recommendation? First of all, I am going to express the greatest mistake students commit all over the world, and that is they simply rewrite the deficiency, full stop, that's it, and they feel we are done. So if the guard is not sitting outside the warehouse, this could lead to theft and the company could suffer. Okay, fine. You have identified the deficiency and you have explained it as well. Fine. Now, when it comes to recommendation, a failure student, an average student will say, there should be a guard outside the warehouse, full stop. And this is not going to give you marks, because you have just repeated the deficiency. The examiner told you in the question that there is no guard outside the warehouse, and you are recommended there should be a guard outside the warehouse. Do you believe that this is going to give you 1 mark? Not at all. Do not just repeat the deficiency, rather try to add value. Say something like that. There should be guard outside the warehouse, and the presence of guard should be monitored along with some CCTV footage, or some CCTV camera should be installed so that the guard should be alert all the time. We need to add value when it comes to recommendation. How can we add value? Who should perform the activity? You should say there should be guard outside each and every warehouse, and the security inspector should randomly visit the warehouses in order to make sure that the guards are always actively and vigilantly present over there. So you need to add value. How come I added value? By recommending guards along with CCTV cameras. How come I added value? I said guards along with security inspector who should monitor all the guards on a sample basis. So how to add value? You should recommend someone senior. You should recommend when should the activity be performed, how often it should be performed. You have to be specific. Do not just repeat the deficiency. Try to add something. Try to add something so that the examiner or the marker can realize that you are not simply rewriting the deficiency, rather you are adding value to your recommendation. You are coming up with something very solid, which will eventually overcome that deficiency. If you are just simply going to rewrite the deficiency, you are not going to overcome the deficiency, and you need to overcome the deficiency. Okay, another exam requirement is key controls. What do I mean by key controls? It is the opposite of deficiency. Key controls means the good controls. These are the controls on which an auditor would like to place reliance on. I would like to trust on them. I would like to place or seek reliance on them. As a result of that reliance, I will reduce my substantive testing. When the controls are operating effectively, I will reduce my sample size when it comes to substantive testing. Substantive testing is my tomorrow's topic. Okay, what are key controls? The key controls are actions that management has taken to reduce the risk of fraud or error. So these are the good controls. In order to get the full mark, you have to explain the risk that the control is designed to mitigate. So you have to explain, considering the fact that there is a guard sitting outside the warehouse that reduces the risk of unauthorized access leading to theft or, you know, loss of company's inventory. So considering the guard is there and he only allows authorized access, this will make sure that there is no unauthorized access and there are no incidents of theft. So you have to explain the key control as well. How are you going to explain it? By explaining or highlighting what benefits we are going to get out of that particular control. How did we explain the poor control? By highlighting the negative consequences. How we are going to explain the key control? By highlighting the good controls, by highlighting the possible advantages of that particular control. Now, please, I told you I will be highlighting the exam techniques. You are going to identify the key control from the question. I think we all agree on that. We'll copy it from the question. No rocket science. But how we are going to explain it? We will explain like this. This minimizes the risk of unauthorized access and as a result, theft. This reduces the risk of unauthorized access leading to theft. This ensures that let's say all the purchase orders are authorized by appropriate signatory level. This ensures that only valid purchases are made which are in the best interest of the company. This ensures that only genuine customers are entertained with good credit history. So this is how you are going to structure your sentence. I hope this helps you in developing your answers. Last, before we go on to a past paper question, how do we write test of control? That's the last thing out of those five requirements. Test of controls are the actions performed by the auditor in order to verify whether the controls are operating effectively. Now, one test of control will give you one mark. For the test of control, usually we inquire with the management. This is our fundamental right to inquire with the management, and they are obliged to answer us. They are obliged to give us reasonable explanation. So the first methodology of performing test of control is to inquire the management. Try to understand what actions they are doing, how they are performing a certain activity. Inquire them. And if there is a process or activity performed by the management on a regular basis, not on an occasional basis, on a regular basis, you can always visit them and observe the process or the activity. That's the method number two of performing test of control. Number third method, if there is a process or an activity or a software used by the client, you can use test data, also known as dummy data, and you can enter fake data and evaluate the results of that particular software. If the results are according to your expectations, you can trust that system. So you can use test data in order to figure out whether the system is operating effectively, yes or no. Last but not the least, the fourth methodology of testing controls is you got to inspect the documents, you got to inspect the reports, you got to select the purchase orders and look for the authorized signatures out of the signatory list just to make sure that all purchase orders are authorized. So you got to select samples of the documents and you got to inspect few things. In order to make sure that all purchase orders are sequentially pre-numbered, you got to select a sample of purchase orders and have a sequential review, make sure there is no missing items. And if there is any missing item, you got to have a discussion with the management. So this is how you write tests of controls. Now the past paper questions. There are four past paper questions right in front of you. Comet Publishing is a question about purchase system. We will be doing this question today. Amberjack sales system. Amberjack is a question on sales system, which we did in the March 2021 day two of the webinar, and I can share the link with you. Okay, Caterpillar is a question on cash system, which we will be doing today. Raspberry is a question on payroll system, which we did on March 2021 webinar day two, and definitely I'll provide the link of that. So today's agenda is Caterpillar and Comet Publishing. Now, before I move on to the Caterpillar or Comet Publishing, if there is any question, please go ahead. Okay, question number one. Can I get yesterday's recording? As far as yesterday's recording is concerned, the link for the yesterday's recording is available to you. Moreover, the link of yesterday's recording is also available in the WhatsApp group. Okay, let's go to the next question. Link to the WhatsApp group. Someone will share you the number. You can text on that number and you'll be added accordingly. Yes. All of you will be added in the WhatsApp group. Don't worry about that. You will be added. Don't worry. You will be added. Don't worry. Sir, key controls was tested in previous attempt and deficiencies also. Yes, they will be. I believe they will be tested again because the examiner report suggests that this is not appropriately attempted by the students. Yes, Numan Anjum, there is a WhatsApp group and you will be added. Don't worry. Okay, as far as tomorrow's lecture is concerned, the link is already available in the WhatsApp group. We will reshare, don't worry. Sorry to interrupt, but when the recordings will be uploaded? The recordings are almost available in 24 hours time. What is the basic difference between test of control and substantive procedures? I always mix up these two. Hamid, I can answer this question, but I would like to answer this question tomorrow because I haven't expressed anything regarding substantive procedures as yet. But just to have a quick answer to that, when I'm applying test of controls, I don't bother about the financial statements. I'm testing the control systems, Hamid, designed by the management. Control system. My agenda and my focus are not the financial statements. But when it comes to substantive procedures, I'm trying to evaluate the financial statements. I'm trying to figure out whether the financial statements are appropriate, yes or no. So this is the difference between the two, but as far as more clarity is concerned, you have to be present in the tomorrow's lecture. How to differentiate between deficiency and key control in a single case, as I mixed up in the last attempt and got flunked. Mohammed Akif, I really hope so that I will be able to help you out in about half an hour's time. In the next half, for your on your request and for your question, I would like to start not from the Comet Publishing, but I would like to start from Caterpillar. Caterpillar is a question which has got key controls as well along with deficiency. So wait a sec, wait for a few minutes. How can we differentiate cash and bank system and cash system? You don't have to differentiate. Don't worry. Is there a new WhatsApp group so that we so please do key controls majorly cover control objectives? Yeah, kind of. The key controls are the good controls. So they tend to highlight the positive side of the company's control system. Okay, let's start the question. Don't worry, the number will be shared and you will be able to join us. Don't worry. Okay, as far as day two is concerned, we are having three questions up in our sleeve: Caterpillar, Comet Publishing, and Saxophoon Enterprise. So let's start with. Okay, guys. Okay, Caterpillar, please concentrate. Requirement number A, state two control objectives of Caterpillar company's cash receipt system. Hardly two control objectives, only two. I told you, examiner is not going to ask you more than three or more than four. Here, the examiner is asking you for two control objectives of company's cash receipt system. You don't need to read the question for that. It's a common sense based question. It's a knowledge based question. So two control objectives could be, first of all, I would like to make sure or to ensure, how to write the answer? To ensure that all cash receipts are recorded in the cash book. To ensure that cash is safeguarded to prevent theft. To ensure that all receipts are recorded at the correct amounts in the cash day book. So these are the control objectives. You got to learn them. Here is the solution: to ensure that all valid cash receipts are received and deposited promptly in the bank. To ensure all cash receipts are recorded in cash book. To ensure that cash is safeguarded to prevent theft. To ensure that cash receipts are recorded in the correct accounting period. To ensure that management has accurate and timely information regarding the cash position. They should be aware, are they in a surplus, are they in a deficit, so that they can have a plan B of it. So this is a knowledge base. I hope this is clear to everyone. You got to learn the control objectives of all the six systems, at least four control objectives of each and every system. I hope this is clear. Let's go to the requirement number B. 6 marks. Identify and explain three key controls in the Caterpillar company's cash receipt system which the auditor may seek to place reliance on. Three key controls. You have to identify good control from the question and then you have to explain it. This will ensure that this reduces the risk of wording such as this one. The auditor may seek to place reliance on, and there is another requirement after that, and describe a test of control the auditor should perform in order to assess whether these controls is operating effectively. Okay, let's not start reading the question. Let's read the requirement number C as well. Identify and explain six deficiencies in the Caterpillar company's cash system and provide a recommendation to address each of these deficiencies. So you have to identify six deficiencies. You have to explain the negative consequences of them. So such as this could lead to loss of future sales. This could result in loss of profitability, loss of reputation, and provide a recommendation to address each of these deficiencies. And when it comes to recommendation, you have to add value. Do not just repeat the deficiency. You have to add value. Is this clear? The requirements are clear. I hope the requirements are clear and you should be thrilled and excited to read this question. And if somebody is wondering how I'm going to differentiate between key controls and deficiencies, let's demonstrate that. Dear students, please realize this is a very important moment of today's webinar. Once you are reading the question, and if you are going to identify a key control, simply go to your answer sheet, and identify that key control, explain that key control, write the test of control of that one. Then move to the next sentence. Maybe in the next sentence, you might be able to identify a deficiency. Once you identify the deficiency, go to the format on the platform of the deficiency one part and identify the deficiency by copying it, explain the deficiency and provide the recommendation. Do not read the question from start, from inception to abandonment. Do not read the whole question first of all and then try to attempt the answers. No. Once you have figured out a particular deficiency, once you have identified a particular key control, attempt it as soon as possible. Promptly attempt it. This is a huge exam technique. Okay, let's start reading the question and we will be doing that. Once we will identify a key control, we'll look into it. Once we'll identify deficiency, we'll look into it. Okay, let's start reading the question. Caterpillar Company is a clothing retailer which operates 45 stores throughout the country. Now, this is important. They have got 45 stores. The company's year end is 31st March 2017. Caterpillar Company has an internal audit department which has undertaken a number of internal control reviews, specifically focusing on cash controls at stores during the year. Have you guys identified any key control or any deficiency? Caterpillar Company has an internal audit department. Good. Which has undertaken a number of internal control reviews. So they are monitoring it. Good. I'm loving it. And they are specifically focusing on cash controls at stores during the year. Fantastic. I believe it's a key control. What I'm going to do is that you are going to copy this. Caterpillar Company has an internal audit department, which has a number of internal control, which has undertaken a number of control internal control reviews, specifically focusing on cash controls at stores during the year. And this is going to give you congratulations, half mark, and you have done nothing but you have just copied the key control from the question. Nothing but you have copied it. Now you have to explain it. And how you have to explain a key control? You have to explain this is a strong monitoring control, and this will ensure that all the stores are adhering or following the company's policies, because they do not wish to be blamed or they do not wish to be highlighted as someone who is not following the SOPs. So if there is any exception found by the internal auditor, they need to be investigated. Caterpillar Company has an internal audit department which has undertaken a number of internal control reviews which specifically focus on cash controls as stored during the year. This is going to give you half mark, and this half mark is all the way from the question itself. Now you have to explain it. This is a strong monitoring control, as stores will aim to ensure that company procedures are maintained. Now imagine you are a store manager. You know that internal audit department will be at your doorstep sooner or later. What you are going to do? You are going to follow all the procedures. You are going to follow all the rules stated in the rule book, because you do not wish to be part of any exceptional report. You do not want to be highlighted in front of the board of directors. So this is a strong monitoring control, and this will ensure that all the stores managers are following the procedures stated in the company's manual, because they do not wish to be highlighted in any exception report created by the internal audit department. So this is the explanation of this particular key control. This will give you half mark, and this will give you another half mark. Now, what about the test of control? How you are going to test this particular control? See, the internal audit department, they kind of review. So what can I do? I can review the internal audit department files for the results of the stores visit. So they must have visited few stores. I would like to review the files in order to confirm that 20 stores were visited. And if there were any exceptions, they were noted and appropriate action was taken. So I would like to review the internal audit department files. I would like to review the internal audit department files in order to confirm a couple of things. Number one, 20 stores according to the program were actually visited. B, if there were any exceptions, the actions were taken accordingly. So I would like to review the internal audit department files in order to confirm A, they actually visited 20 largest stores. B, if there are any exceptions noted, whether the actions were taken or not. There are two tests of controls in the solution by the examiner. You have to understand both of them, but on the exam day, you have to write one. If you are going to write all this, you will still get one mark. And if you are going to write only this, you will still get one mark. Okay, let's continue with the question. The reviews have taken place in the largest 20 stores as this is where most issues arise. Is this a key control or a weak control? How many stores do they have? They have got 45 stores and they are reviewing only what? The largest 20 stores. Is it a key control or a poor control? This is a poor control. How this is a poor control? The internal audit department only undertake reviews. The internal audit department undertakes reviews on the largest 20 stores as this is where most issues arise. Out of the 45 stores, only 20 largest stores are reviewed as where the most issues arise. There is a risk, or this increases the possibility that there could be errors in other stores which might go undetected. Considering it's a cash-based business, the risk of fraud and error is on the higher side. So this is the deficiency, this is the poor control. Out of 45 stores, only 20 stores are reviewed by the internal audit department as this is where most issues arise. Considering all others, the other 25 stores are not visited, this increases the risk of fraud and error in other stores. Considering this is a cash-based business, the risk of fraud and error is on the higher side. What should be the recommendation? How are you going to recommend? I think the recommendation should be the internal audit department should come up with a floating program. They should try to visit each and every store at least once a year. They could give more importance to, you know, most important 20 stores, but they should try to come up with a plan in which on a rolling basis, they should visit other stores as well. This is the recommendation. The internal audit department only undertakes cash control visits to the 20 largest store as they feel this is where the most issues arise. This is all copied from the question. However, company has 45 stores in total, which means over half of the stores are not being checked. This increases the likelihood of control errors as these stores may not comply with company procedures. I am a stores manager. I know that my store is never visited by the internal audit department. What do you think? Will I be following all the company procedures? I really don't think so. So there is a huge amount of risk that those store managers are not complying with the company procedures because they know for sure that they are not going to be visited by the internal audit department. What should be the recommendation? Caterpillar Company's internal audit department should have a rolling program of visits to all 45 stores. Yes, they can be biased to the high value stores, but they should try to make sure that on a cyclical basis, they end up visiting all possible stores. This is the recommendation. If you're going to say they should visit all 45 stores for full stop, this is not good enough. You have to add value. How you are going to add value? They should come up with a rolling program. They should focus on the high risk stores, but on a cyclical basis, they should try to visit other stores as well. Recommendation. Let's continue. So for now, we have figured out one key control. and one deficiency for now. Okay. You are an audit supervisor of Woodloose and you are reviewing the internal control document. Each of Caterpillar company store has an average 3 or 4 cash stills to take customer payments. All employees based at the store are able to use each till, and individuals do not have their own logon codes, although employees tend to use the same till each day. Please read this sentence again. You might be able to figure out a key deficiency or a poor control. Each of the Caterpillar company store has on average 3 or 4 cash stills. So there are 3 or 4 cash stills in order to take the customer payments. All employees based at the store are able to use each till. So I can use this till, I can use that till, I can use that till, no problem. And they do not have their own logon codes. So what is it? Is it a good control or a bad control? It is a bad control, poor control. How are you going to write it? All employees based on the store are able to use each till, and individuals do not have their own logon codes. As a result, what could happen? Allowing all employees to access each other's till could result in risk of fraud and error. And moreover, if there could be any discrepancy, you won't be able to figure out who is to be blamed and who is responsible. What should be your recommendation? I think the recommendation should be that only employees with a designated password or login code should be allowed to access a till, and not each and every employee should be allowed to access each other's till. All store employees are able to use each till and none have an individual logon code when using the till. Allowing all employees access to the till point increases the risk of fraud and error arising. Only each employee should have a designated till and a logon code which is required for each payment transaction. So if I have to receive a payment, I need to log on to my unique logon code with a unique till, otherwise I won't be able to process it. So you have to identify the deficiency from the question, then you have to explain. There is another explanation as well. In the event of cash discrepancies arising in the tills, so if there is a discrepancy, it would be difficult to figure out which employee is responsible, because there is no delegation, there is no unique till, there is no unique password. Anyone can use any till. As a result, if there is a discrepancy, everyone is going to blame the other one. No one is going to accept it. Okay, customers can pay using either cash or credit card for any transaction. Either the credit card payment slips or cash are placed in the till by the cashier. Where employees, friends or family members purchase clothes in store, the employee is able to serve them at the till point. Now please read the sentence again. Is it a key control or a poor control? Employees, friends or family members purchase. Where employees, friends or family members purchase clothes in store, the employee is able to serve them at the till point. This increases the risk of fraud, because there is a possibility that I might not charge my friend or my family member, and as a result, company could suffer. I might grant heavy discounts or unnecessary or undue discount to my relative or my family member, and as a result, company could be, you know, bearing unnecessary or unauthorized discounts. What should be the recommendation? I think the company should have a policy in place whereby whenever an employee's friends or relative is there, that whole transaction should be supervised by the supervisor, or there should be CCTV cameras in place in order to make sure that there are no such events. Where employees, friends or family members purchase clothes in store, the employee is able to serve them at the till point. So this is how you are going to copy the deficiency from the question. Now you have to explain it. There is a significant fraud risk as employee could fail to put the goods through the till but retain the cash paid by the friend or family member in their pocket. Or alternatively, they could give the goods away for free or undercharge for goods sold, thereby granting unauthorized discounts. And obviously, this is going to be a loss for the company. What should be the recommendation for this one? Caterpillar company should instigate a policy whereby employees are unable to serve friends or family members at the till point. So you are not allowed to serve or entertain your friends or family at the till point. They should be required to request that a manager or supervisor put these goods through the till. So whenever a friend or a family member is there, I should step back. I should ask the manager that or a supervisor that, please, sir, you do this. I'm not all allowed to do this particular transaction according to the policy. At the end of each day, the tills are closed down. Fantastic. That sounds good. With daily readings of sales taken from each till. These are reconciled to the total of cash in tills and the credit card payment slips, and any discrepancies are noted. Is this a good control or a bad control? At the end of each day, the tills are closed down with daily readings of sales taken from each till. Continue with that. These are reconciled to the total of the cash and tills and the credit card payment slips, and any discrepancies are noted. So whatever the tills balance is, I reconcile it with the cash and the credit card receipts just to make sure that there are no discrepancies. This is a very good control. It's a key control. And how to explain it? You have to explain it that if there is any discrepancy that could be identified, and if there is any fraud or error that could be identified on a promptly manner, and we can figure out where the problem is. At the end of each day, the tills are closed down with the daily readings of sales taken. These are reconciled to the total of cash in the tills and the credit card payment slips, and any discrepancies are noted. This will give you half mark. All you have to do is copy it from the question. Now you have to explain it. Daily cashing up procedures. What are you going to do? This is called cashing up procedure. You are adding it up. Daily cashing up procedure should ensure that cash is controlled and reduces the risk of fraud, as employees are aware that assistant manager will be looking for cash discrepancies. As I know that at the end of the day, the balance of my till will be reconciled with the cash in hand and with the credit card receipt. I will avoid any fraud, because I know someone is going to reconcile it. And if there is any unreconciled amount, I will be held responsible for that. So daily cashing up procedure should ensure that cash is controlled and reduces the risk of fraud, as employees are aware that assistant manager will be looking for any discrepancies. What should be the test of control? For reconciliations performed by the assistant manager, discuss the discrepancies and figure it out what actions were taken and were they resolved. So according to the question, the assistant manager identifies any discrepancies. So I would like to perform a test of control by having a discussion with the store manager and by evaluating what actions were taken and whether the issues were resolved, yes or no. To save time, this reconciliation is done by store's assistant manager in aggregate for all of the store tills together. Is this a key control or a weak control? The store manager is not performing the reconciliation on a till by till basis. Rather, the reconciliation is performed on a total basis. Is this a weak control or a good control? This is a weak control, poor control, because if there is any discrepancy or exception, it will be difficult to identify that who did this mistake. Who is the fraudster? Who needs the training? So this is a problem. What should be the recommendation? I think the reconciliations should be undertaken on an individual till by till basis so that any discrepancies should be investigated accordingly. The daily reading of sales and reconciliations to the till is performed in aggregate rather than for each till. This means if exceptions arise, it will be difficult to identify which till caused the difference and therefore which employee may require further either the training or he or she is involved in a fraud. The recommendation, the reconciliation should be undertaken on an individual till by till basis rather than on an aggregate basis. Once this reconciliation has taken place, the cash is stored in the shop small safe overnight, and in the morning it is transferred to the bank via collection by a security company. Now there is one deficiency and one key control in this sentence. Please read this sentence by yourself again. There is one deficiency and there is one key control in this one. There is one deficiency. Now, what's the deficiency? The cash is stored in the shop small safe. That small shop safe is not safe or good enough. In the Fast Five, they took away the whole vault with them. So as far as this small safe is concerned, it is very convenient for someone to steal cash. So the cash is kept at the store overnight in a small safe. Although it is safe, this is not secure enough. And as a result, the cash is at risk of being stolen overnight. What should be the recommendation? I think the cash should not be secured overnight in the safe. Rather, it should be banked on a daily basis. Simple as that. Now, what's the key control here? The cash is collected by a security company. Considering the cash is received from customers, is then taken by the security company, this ensures the cash is safeguarded and there is no risk of theft during the transferring of cash. What should be the test of control? I think I can visit the stores and I can observe whether the cash collection company is there and do they collect the cash at the end of each day. I can observe all this. Read it, please read this. The cash is kept at store overnight in a small safe. Although in a safe, this is not secure as it is likely that the cash sales for one day would be a significant sum. The cash is at risk of being stolen overnight. What should be the recommendation? The cash should continue to be collected by daily by the security company, but rather than in the morning, it should be collected as the stores closes in the evening. So rather than in the morning, why don't they come in the evening and they collect it and they bank it at least before the closing of bank time, so that a significant amount is banked on a daily basis. We don't have to put significant amount in the safe for the overnight period. As far as the key control is concerned, cash received from customer is taken to the bank daily via collection by a security company. This ensures that cash is safeguarded and the risk of theft is minimized. During your visits to the stores, you can observe that these collection process is carried out by the security company. Okay. So as far as the requirements are concerned, we had to identify three key controls. We had to identify six deficiencies. We have already done that, but let's finish this question quickly. Okay. Once this reconciliation has taken place, the cash is stored in the shop small safe night of and in the morning. Okay, if the store is low on a change for cash payment, a junior sales clerk is sent by a till operator to the bank with money from the till and asked to change it into a smaller denominations. So there is no documentation here. There is a possibility that junior sales clerk and the and maybe the concerned manager, they collude and they commit some fraud or error. So company should come up with a certain policy. They should float some cash on a daily basis in lower denominations, so they don't have to send someone. The daily sales reading from the tills along with cash data and credit card payment data are transferred daily to the head office through an interface with the sales and cash receipt records. Now, this is a key control. A clerk oversees that this transfer has occurred for all stores on a daily basis. He also agrees cash transferred by the security company has been banked in full by agreeing the cash deposit slips to the bank statements and that credit card receipts have been received from the credit card company. So a clerk is involved in too many things. This is a lack of segregation of duty. One clerk is responsible for several elements of the cash receipt system. He oversees the daily interface, also agrees the cash has cleared into the bank statement, and also performs the bank reconciliation. I told you there is a lack of segregation of duty, and errors will not be identified on a timely basis, as well as increasing the risk of fraud, considering he is on his own. So he or she might commit a fraud and they will go undetected. What should be your recommendation? These key roles should be split between a few individuals, with ideally the bank reconciliation being undertaken by another member of the finance team. Remember, whenever you have to recommend something against the, you know, segregation of duty, always come up with this, that the at least the bank reconciliation should be performed by someone extremely unrelated to all that activity. Bank reconciliation is a very important control, and that should be performed by someone from the finance department, from the finance team, but not relevant to all those activities. On a monthly basis, the same clerk reconciles the bank statements into the cash book. The reconciliations are reviewed by the financial controller if there are unreconciled items. So there is one key control and one poor control. What is the key control? The reconciliations are reviewed by the financial controller. So if there are any discrepancies, they will be identified and actions will be taken. That's a key control. What's the poor control? The reconciliations are reviewed by the financial controller if there are reconciled items. So if there are no reconciled items, if there are no unreconciling items, the reconciliation is not performed. Maybe there are certain mistakes which have cancelled out each other. So the reconciliation should be performed even if there are no unreconciled items. The bank reconciliations are only reviewed by the financial controller if there are in unreconciled items. That should not be the case. The bank reconciliation could reconcile but still contain errors because there are compensating errors. So what should be the recommendation? The bank reconciliation should be reviewed by the financial controller on a monthly basis, even if there are no exceptions. And he should sign that by way of signature on the bank reconciliation so that there should be an evidence that he performed the bank reconciliation and he reviewed it. So that there is an evidence that he reviewed the bank reconciliation. So that was a very complicated question. You had to identify control deficiencies and you had to identify key controls as well. What's the key control? Bank reconciliations are undertaken on a monthly basis. That's the key control. What is the benefit of it? This should ensure that, I told you this wording, this should help you. This should ensure that any discrepancies between the cash book and the bank statements are identified promptly. Okay, let's go to another question, which is called comment publishing. Part A, explain the safeguards which each company should implement to ensure that the identified conflict of interest is properly managed. You all are familiar with conflict of interest. Halley company has recently accepted the audit engagement of a new client, Edmond company, which is the main competitor of Comet Publishing. The finance director of Comet Publishing has required how Halley and company will keep information obtained during the audit confidential. We did this particular question yesterday. We are going to have separate engagement teams. We are going to have separate engagement partners. We are going to make sure that there is restricted access to information by using different offices or data filing. We are going to make sure that all the engagement team members of both the clients, they sign confidentiality agreement. We will advise both the clients to get independent advice. And last but not the least, we will make sure that a quality controller reviewer ensures that all controls are being adhered and practiced religiously. So this is part A, we all know that. Explain the steps the auditor should take to confirm the accuracy of the purchase and payable flow chart and systems notes currently held on the file. This is another knowledge base. You should be familiar what are flow charts. You should be familiar what are narrative notes. You should be familiar what are internal control questionnaires and internal control evaluation questionnaires. Now, first of all, what are flow charts? Let's start with the narrative notes. If you are going to explain how the client's control systems operate in the form of words, in the form of narration, this is called narrative notes. Narrative notes are usually prepared either by the client itself or by the internal audit department, or as an auditor, we can prepare the narrative notes as well in order to understand how the internal control systems are working. So you need to learn the definition of narrative notes. You need to learn the advantage and disadvantage of narrative notes. What's the advantage of narrative notes? Narrative notes are easier for someone new so that they can identify how the system is operating. But considering narrative notes are sentences, they could be too lengthy and too time consuming. What are flow charts? These are diagrams through which a system is established. So the flow charts will explain who is responsible, what job description does that have, to whom he is responsible to or reportable to. So this is flow chart. Flow charts have advantages and disadvantages as well. The advantage of flow chart is they are easy to understand, they are quick to understand, they are easy to prepare. But the disadvantage of flow chart is if you have to amend the flow chart, maybe you have to make a new flow chart. So that could be a problem. Okay, the third knowledge based part in this internal control system is narrative notes, flow charts, then comes questionnaires. There are two types of questionnaires, internal control questionnaires and internal control evaluation questionnaires. Internal control questionnaires, auditor will provide a ready-made list to the client and they will say, this is the list of controls. Those controls which you have designed and implemented, please tick them, mark them as yes. And those which you have not designed and implemented, please cross them. This is a ready-made list provided by the auditor to the client. And this is a very quick method of evaluating a client's internal control system. This is called internal control questionnaires. But on the contrary, there is another method which is called internal control evaluation questionnaires. And in the internal control evaluation questionnaires, the auditor will ask the client that this is the risk, this is the potential deficiency, what controls you have in place in order to counter that risk. So the client is going to provide you with a list. This is called internal control evaluation questionnaires. Let's go to the part C. We are not in a position to attempt part D because part D has got to do with the substantive procedures. So let's focus on part C. In respect of the purchases and payable system for Comet Publishing Company, identify and explain five deficiencies. So we have to identify five deficiencies from the question. Then we will explain the negative sides of those deficiencies. So identify and explain five deficiencies. That will give us 5 marks. Recommend a control to address each of these deficiencies. Then we will suggest good control in order to overcome those deficiencies. Another 5 marks. Then after recommending a control, we have to describe a test of control the auditor should perform in order to assess whether the controls implemented, if implemented, are operating effectively. So read the requirement number 3 again. Describe a test of control the auditor should perform to assess if each of these controls, if implemented, what kind of controls which you recommended in the part 2 is, let's assume they have been implemented, whether they are operating effectively to reduce the identified deficiency, whether the control is operating effectively. Okay, let's start reading the question. So we need to identify the deficiencies from the question. That's it. You are an audit supervisor of H company and you are reviewing the documentation describing Comet Publishing Company's purchase and payable system in preparation for the interim and final audit for the year ending 30th September 2017. The company is a retailer of books and has 10 stores and a central warehouse which holds the majority of the company's inventory. So I'm done with the first paragraph. And I did not find any deficiency as yet. Okay, wait a second, let me. Okay, I'm exploring few questions. So Ojoyo, you have asked, is it possible to get yesterday's notes, questions and solutions? Yes, I will provide you each and everything all over again in the WhatsApp group. Don't worry. Yes, you are right. You are right. So no segregation. Well done. Well done. So you have all, I have responded well. Sir, in control, there is also another requirement of strength and further improvement about the chance of this requirement. Strength means good control. So if examiner has asked you to explain the strengths of a particular control system, that's one and the same thing. The examiner is asking you to identify and explain the key control. Key control, good control, a control on which an auditor can place reliance on, or a strength of a system, these are all one and the same thing. Is this clear, Kabir? Sir, in the control, there is also another requirement. Okay, this. If a statement has part key and part deficiency in it, is it safe to use the statement to attempt answer both key and a deficiency requirement? For example, examiner comes up with a sentence in which there is one deficiency or one aspect of that control is a good control, but another aspect of that same control is a deficiency. Yes, you are allowed to entertain the positive aspect of it in the key control section, and you are allowed to take the negative side of it as a deficiency. You can use it. If I hope this is clear now. Okay, Kabir, if the examiner is going to ask you further improvements, you have to realize that there is a good control, but what more could have been done? For example, the bank reconciliation is performed, so it's a good control, but there should be someone senior who should review the bank reconciliations in order to figure out if there is any discrepancy. So if there is a bank reconciliation be performed, and if there are any exceptions being noted, the improvement could be, and if there is any discrepancy, the corrective action should be instigated promptly, and the corrective action should be taken on a prompt basis. So you have to add something in it. Any other question? Okay, let's continue with the question then. Once I'm done with this comment publishing, I will explore more questions, so you can post your questions in the comment in the question box. Okay, let's concentrate on this question. Few paragraphs, that's it. So we are done with the first paragraph and we have found no deficiency whatsoever. Okay, your firm has audited Comet Publishing for a number of years, and as such, audit documentation is available from the previous year's file. So you do have the file and you do know what their system is like, including internal control flow charts and detailed purchases and payable system notes. Okay, fine. As far as you are aware, Comet Publishing Company's system of internal control has not changed in the last year. Okay, fine. I haven't found any deficiency as yet. The audit manager is keen for the team to utilize existing system documentation in order to ensure that audit efficient, in order to ensure audit efficiency. Okay, fine. An extract from the existing system note is provided below. Students, please realize I'm done with the first two paragraph and I have not found any deficiency as yet. And even in the last paragraph, there is no deficiency because that part has got to do with the conflict of interest. So we are left with these three paragraphs only, and we need to identify five deficiencies. Okay, fine. Let's continue. Store managers are responsible for ordering books for their shop. It is not currently possible for store managers to request books from any other 9 stores. Customer who wish to order books which are not in stock at a particular branch, they are told to contact the other stores directly or visit the company's website. Is this a key control? Well, we are not asked to identify key control. Is this a deficiency? Definitely it is. It is not possible for a store to order goods from other local stores. So there are no inter-branch transfers available. So the customers are less likely to visit the other store or the company website. And as a result, the company is going to lose future sales. The company is going to lose valuable sales. What should be the recommendation? I think there should be a system of inter-branch transfers between the stores with the help of inter-branch inventory forms, so that if you are short of something and I am having more than enough quantity of that, we can share stuff. If I am having huge piles of, you know, certain items and those items are getting obsolete at my store, I can transfer those items to a neighboring store so that we can get rid of those, you know, slow moving items. So that's the recommendation. What should be the test of control? I think we need to inspect a sample of completed inter-branch inventory forms. I recommended there should be a system of inter-branch transfers along with inter-branch transfer forms. So I would like to select a sample of completed inter-branch transfer forms in order to verify that the system of inter-branch transfer is operating effectively. Now see how they have copied it from the question. It is not possible for a store to order goods from other local stores for customers who request them. Instead, customers are told to contact the other stores or use the company website. This is half mark and this is all from the question, copied. You don't have to type it. Now the explanation. Customers are less likely to contact individual stores themselves, and this could result in the company losing valuable sales. That's it, another half mark. What should be the recommendation? There should be an inter-branch transfer system with the help of inter-branch inventory forms so that the stores can transfer stuff with each other. Test of control. Inspect a sample of completed inter-branch inventory transfer forms for confirming that the control is operating effectively. Let's continue. As the inventory levels fall in a store, the store manager raises a purchase acquisition form, well done, which is then sent to the central warehouse, well done. If there is insufficient inventory held, so if the central warehouse does not have sufficient inventory, what happens then? A supplier requisition form is completed, well done, and sent to the purchase order clerk, well done. What's the name of the purchase order clerk? Oliver. What happens then? He sends any orders above 1000 for authorization from the purchasing director. What does that mean? It means that if there is any order below $1,000, the purchase clerk does not require any authorization. This could result in non-business related purchases. This could lead to risk of fraud because the clerk knows that up to a value of $1,000, he does not require any authorization. So he might be having unrelated purchases or personal stuff being purchased from the company account. What should be the recommendation? I think all purchase orders should be authorized by a responsible official. Now, this is just repeating the deficiency. I need to add value. How do I add value? We could have authorized signatory list for the different or varying levels of purchases. For different levels of purchases, we should have different levels of signatory levels. What does that mean? Let's say up to an amount of 1000, Mr. Ahmed can authorize that. up to an amount of 2000, Mr. let's say Kabir can authorize that. Over and above 2000, Mr. Gupta can authorize that. So this is how we are going to establish a signatory list. What should be the test of control? We will select a sample of purchase orders and we will review for the evidence of signature. There should be appropriate signature in each and every purchase order. Is this clear? Let's explore the solution of this. First of all, we have to copy all that from the question. Purchase orders below 1000 are not authorized and are processed solely by the purchase order clerk, who is also responsible for processing invoices. This could result in non-business related purchases, and there is increased risk of fraud as clerk could place orders for personal goods up to the value of 1000. I know for sure that up to the $1,000, I don't need any authorization. So I can purchase whatever I want to because I don't need any authorization. This is a flaw in the system. How to overcome that flaw? I think all purchase orders should be authorized, but not all purchase orders can be authorized by the director, right? So we need to develop a signatory level. Varying levels of purchase orders should be authorized by different signatories. So this is the recommendation. What should be the test of control? Select a sample of purchase orders and review it for the evidence of authorization and make sure that approved signatures are over there, are placed over there. Let's continue. Receipt of goods from suppliers are processed by the warehouse team who agreed the delivery to the purchase order, checking the quantity and quality of goods, and complete a sequentially numbered good receive note. The good receive note are sent to the accounts department every 2 weeks for processing. Now, there are two major deficiencies here. Number one, good receive notes are sent to the accounts department after 2 weeks. Now, what does that mean? We have received the goods, but we haven't notified the accounts department. As a result, we might not be able to get early settlement discount because the accounts department is unaware. Moreover, at the year end, our liabilities could be understated. Moreover, our supplier could be offended because they will be receiving their payments late because the good received note was sent to the accounts department late. What should be the recommendation of that? The copy of the good received note should be sent to the accounts department on a promptly basis. I think on a regular basis. What should be the test of control? I think we need to inquire the accounts department the frequency of the good receive note. Whether do they receive the good receive note on the very same date? Yes or no? There is another deficiency here, and that is the good receive note is receipt of the goods from supplier are processed by the warehouse who agree the delivery to purchase order, checking the good receive note are sent to the accounts department only. So there is no evidence that the good receive note is sent to the purchasing department as well. If the good receive note is not sent to the ordering department, there is a possibility that ordering department won't be able to identify the unfulfilled orders. And once the unfulfilled orders are not identified by the ordering department on a timely basis, we could lose future sales. We could lead ourselves in a stock out situation. So what should be the recommendation? One copy of the good receive note is usually retained by the warehouse department. One copy is sent to the accounts department, but very importantly, or equally importantly, one copy should be sent to the ordering department as well, so that on a regular basis, they should review any unfulfilled orders with the relevant supplier. That's the recommendation. One copy of the good receive note should be sent to the ordering department so that they can figure out any unfulfilled orders on a timely basis with the relevant supplier. What should be the test of control? You need to review the file and you need to figure out whether one copy is sent to the ordering department. You can inquire with the ordering department whether do they receive the copy of the good receive note. Once the order has been received, you can inquire them. And once they have received the copy, do they flag it as complete? So imagine yourself as the ordering department. you have received a goods receipt note, what you are supposed to do, you need to flag it as a completed order because the goods which you ordered have now been received. Let's explore the solution of it. Number one deficiency, goods receipt notes are sent to the accounts department after 2 weeks. This is a serious delay, and this delay could result in understated liabilities. Moreover, you would lose prompt payment discounts. What should be the recommendation? The copy of the GRN should be sent to the accounts department on a regular basis, such as daily. What should be the test of control? Inquire the accounts department. What is the frequency of GRN? Whether they do receive the GRN on a promptly basis? Another deficiency, good receive notes are only sent to the accounts department. If you are not going to send a copy of the GRN to the ordering department, they won't be able to identify unfulfilled orders, and as a result, you could lead to, this could lead to stockouts and a loss of future sales. Recommendation, the GRN should be created in 3 parts, and 1 part should be sent to the ordering department, and they should perform a review of unfulfilled orders, and they should chase up those orders with the relevant supplier. Review the file of copy with GRN held by the purchase ordering clerk, Oliver, and review for evidence that these are matched to the orders and flagged as complete. Okay, last paragraph. On receipt of the purchase invoice from the supplier, an accounts clerk matches it to the GRN. The invoice is then sent to the purchase ordering clerk, Oliver, who processes it for payment. So I believe Oliver is involved in too many things. Oliver, there is a lack of segregation of duty. Don't you think so? The purchase ordering clerk, Oliver, has responsibility for ordering goods below 1,000 and for processing all invoices. There is a lack of segregation of duty, and this increases the risk of fraud and non-business related purchases being made, because he's also placing orders, he's also processing it. So this is very convenient for him, so that he can create a non-business related item and he can process it by on his own. What should be the recommendation? I think the role of the purchase ordering and in processing should be split into two. Another member of the staff should be added so that one could, you know, one could process the orders and one could process the invoices. So this should be divided into two. And what should be the test of control? You can observe this whole process, making sure that not one single individual is involved, rather two individuals are involved. Okay. The finance director is given the total amount of payment list, which she authorizes and then processes the bank payment. Now, here is another deficiency. The finance director is given the total amount. She does not have the details. The finance director authorizes the bank transfer payment list for suppliers. However, she only reviews the total amount of payments to be made. Without looking at the details of the payment list, without having the supporting documentation, there is a possibility that fictitious suppliers could be paid or incorrect amounts could be paid. What should be the recommendation? The finance director should review it, but she should review it along with the supporting documentation, and she should get the breakdown of the whole payment. What should be the test of control? You need to review the payment list and you need to make sure that finance director is provided with the supporting documentation. Last, due to staff shortages in the accounts department, supplier statement reconciliations are no longer performed. I told you, look out for the word no. So supplier statement reconciliations are no longer performed. What happens then? If supplier statement reconciliations are no longer performed, let's check it out. Supplier statement reconciliations are no longer performed. This is from the question itself. This may result, or this could result in, errors in the recording of purchase and payables not being identified in a timely manner. Obviously, the error will be identified once the customer is going to raise a concern, and that will be too late. So once, if you are not creating supplier statement reconciliations on a timely basis, this creates a potential error, or this could lead you to an error, the errors not being identified on a timely basis. What should be the recommendation? please watch this recommendation. Supplier statement reconciliation should be performed on a monthly basis for all suppliers, and these should be reviewed by a responsible official. If you are going to say supplier statement reconciliation should be performed on a monthly basis, not enough. You are just rewriting the deficiency. You have to add value. Supplier statement reconciliation should be performed on a monthly basis. Moreover, these should be reviewed by a responsible official so that if there is any discrepancy, that should be resolved on a timely basis. Test of control, review the file of reconciliation to ensure that they are being performed on a regular basis and they have been reviewed by a responsible official. So you review the file and you need to make sure that reconciliations are performed on a monthly basis and they are being reviewed by someone senior on a regular basis. You can always re-perform few of the reconciliations in order to make sure that they are performed appropriately. Okay, that was internal control systems. As I told you earlier, we do have 6 internal control systems in our syllabus. As far as purchase system and bank and cash system is concerned, we covered bank and cash and purchase system today. If you want to have a deep, you know, understanding of the sales system and a very complicated payroll system, you need to watch the day 2 of the last session's webinar. I will provide you the link of that particular webinar in the group today. As for now, if there is any question, please raise your question before we move on to the minor topic, corporate governance. Okay, wait. Okay, should we take into consideration the cost benefit analysis when recommending control? Definitely you should. Considering cost versus benefit analysis, you should come up with recommendation. So if there is a potential fraud of £1,000 and you are recommending a control costing £1,000,000, that's not worth it. The client is not going to follow that recommendation. So you should consider the cost versus benefit analysis. Well done. Okay. Yes, this is a deficiency, Idrisa. He can make any purchases he want to because there is no, you know, supervision. Isn't recommending inter-branch transfer addressing a business risk? What's the audit risk in this? Oh. When you are recommending inter-branch transfers, you are suggesting a good control. Why? Because currently, their system does not facilitate inter-branch transfers. So we are not discussing business risk here. Business risk is not part of audit and assurance syllabus. Business risk is part of the advanced audit and assurance syllabus. So let's not confuse ourselves. How many parts of the purchase order should be produced? Well, if you have, let's talk about good receive note. That should be 3 part at least. One copy should be held by the warehouse department itself. One copy should be sent to the ordering department so they should be aware that the order has been received. And one copy should be sent to the accounts department because they have to make the payment for it. At least 3 parts. For the purchase orders, can I also add 2 signatories for the purchase order to be valid? Yes, you can. But ideally speaking, you should come up with certain threshold for a certain amount. Up to a certain amount, only one signature is required, but over and above that, there should be another signatory added to that list. That makes more sense. Sir, in the test of controls, we use action verbs at the start. Yeah, you can, but not necessarily. You can structure your sentence in some other way around. Sir, sending good receive note to ordering department, how does it lead to loss of sales? it does not lead to loss of sales. If you're not going to send GRN to the ordering department, it could lead to stockouts, and the stockouts will eventually lead to loss of sales. Let me explain it a bit more. I am the goods receiving department. So I have received the goods. I received the goods from a certain supplier, and I did not receive the goods from a certain supplier, and I did not send the copy to the ordering department. The ordering department is unaware. The ordering department is assuming that all the goods have been received. On the contrary, certain goods have not been received. Because the ordering department is unaware, they are not going to follow up with the supplier. And as a result of not having a proper follow-up, the supplier is not going to deliver. Once the supplier is not going to deliver, the company is going to face stock out. And once the company is going to face stock out, this could result in loss of future sales. Is this clear now, Abdullah? Okay, Fatma is saying break, please. Server, can we have a break of 5 minutes? Yes, we can have. I will start the minor topic of corporate governance in after the break. Sir, re-performing installation, can that be a test of control because it's a substantive procedure as well? Yes, but here I'm re-performing the reconciliation just to make sure that the results produced by their reconciliation is one and the same. Yes. Moreover, if you are not comfortable with that, you just simply select a sample of reconciliations performed by the client just to make sure A, they have been performed, B, they have been reviewed, and authorized signatures are there. More importantly, if there was any issue that have been resolved and identified promptly. What if a good recommendation requires more than one element to be highly effective? How will we get full marks just to give one element? See, in order to come up with good recommendation, you have to add a little value. You have to say who should do it, how often. So you have to add something valuable, something more than the deficiency itself. That's great, Ahad, that's great. Any other question for now? Okay, guys, if there is any other question, you can post that question. And if a deficiency is followed by a good control, will it be considered as a key control? Abdul Mohid, I answered this question earlier as well. If there is a sentence expressing both deficiency and a control, a particular control has got two sides of it. This is a control that bank reconciliations are performed. This is a poor control that there is no follow-up of that reconciliation. So you can enjoy the both things. You can highlight it as a key control as well. You can highlight it as a poor control as well. But the wording should be different. Is this clear, Mohit? Okay, it's approximately 4 p.m. on my clock. Let's have a break of 10 minutes. It's 3:58 p.m. according to my laptop. So we'll start, or we'll resume rather, with a corporate governance topic, with a minor topic at 4:10 p.m. Moreover, you can post your questions, and before starting the corporate governance, I will start, or I will answer your questions. So if there is any question, you can post your questions for now. There is a break for 10 minutes. I'll resume. Please do not ignore minor topics. Those students who are going to fail the exam are the ones who are going to ignore the minor topics. So don't be a fool and don't leave the meeting for now and attend the corporate governance section as well. It's not all about internal controls in the paper. You never know, you might end up having 10 marks out of corporate governance in the exam. So stay tuned. So see you after 10 minutes. Hello, 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 hello. Okay, let's. Before I start corporate governance, let me see if there is any question which I need to address. For knowledge-based questions, should we take the name of the client and write down the answers? Normally speaking, as far as knowledge-based question is concerned, you don't need to utilize the name of the client. And if there is any 1% possibility of doing that, yes, you can do that. But normally speaking, knowledge-based question has got nothing to do with the name of the client. I hope that answers the questions. Okay, how to join the WhatsApp group? The number is provided to you. You can contact on that number. You can message on that number. It will take a couple of hours, but definitely you will be joined. Don't worry. Okay, another question is from Gorakh. Performance materiality. Materiality and performance materiality are interrelated concepts. As an auditor, there is an amount, a quantitative threshold, which I believe as an auditor that I need to select samples over and above that materiality level. Below that materiality level, if there is any misstatement, I can ignore or I can digest it. That's called materiality. But sometimes the auditor sometimes there is a possibility that those unaudited areas, which were immaterial to begin with, there is a possibility that those unaudited areas might have immaterial misstatements, and those immaterial misstatements as an aggregate might be material. So as an auditor, we come up with a new materiality level for that particular area of the audit, and that new materiality level, lower than the original materiality level, it's called performance materiality. Do you have to refer to the ISA within your answers? As far as the risk question is concerned, no. As far as control question is concerned, no. As far as substantive procedure is concerned, no. Okay, in regards to the, okay. Do you prefer to ISA within your answers? No, you don't need to refer ISAs within your answers. As far as knowledge base is concerned, if you will be able to refer it, good for you, but that won't make any difference. So if somebody is not going to refer ISAs, that individual might end up scoring 13 marks out of 15 marks in the knowledge base. And if somebody is going to refer, that particular student might be able to get one extra mark, 14 out of 15 marks. So there's no debate on that. Any other question? As far as students who are texting me on that number to add me in the WhatsApp group and also sending me question marks, I will do it. But right now I'm not in a position to do that. Once the webinar is over and after a couple of hours, I will do it. Don't worry, my promise. Any other question? Okay, another question from Hamid. Sir, the paper is highly depends on section A, but there are not enough questions in kit to practice. There are two kits available for the section A, Kaplan and VPP. And I urge and I recommend that you should solve Kaplan and VPP both for the sake of MTQs at least twice each. As far as section B is concerned, you don't need to open VPP kit. Only one kit is enough. Not even full Kaplan kit is required. You have to solve few questions from Kaplan kit and then move to the past papers. But as those kids are extremely important for your section A. For the sake of section A, you need to attempt each and every MTQ twice from both kids. Moreover, there is a gift for all of you from my side. There is one gift, and that gift is called selective questions. Selective questions from the examiner's report from the recent past papers. I will share that file at the end of the webinar, probably on the fifth day in the WhatsApp group. Those are the selective MCQs by the examiner. Those are the particular MCQs which have been wrongly attempted by the greater majority of students all over the world. Is this clear? I will share that file. Amit, I'm so sorry to hear that, but see, I told you that there are three major characteristics of failure students. Let's ignore typing speed. Let's ignore typing speed for now. Let's ignore the exam techniques. I believe all of you are familiar with the exam technique. So let's ignore these two things. But still, there are three things which are the reasons of a high failure rate. Number one, ignoring MTQs. Number second, ignoring minor areas. Number third, ignoring knowledge based. So if you're not going to repeat such mistakes, nobody is going to fail this exam. Trust me on that. You have to invest 1 hour daily on knowledge base. You are not going to give less importance to the minor areas. You have to give respect to ethics. You have to give respect to corporate governance. Last but not the least, as far as MTQs are concerned, 6 MTQs per day, and you have to spend quality time on the solution of that as well. Miss Fatma, as far as this particular issue is concerned, the exam cancellation issue is concerned, I truly believe on that ACCA Pakistan will come up with a solution. As far as in Pakistan, they will come up with a solution, and they will try to pursue government that these are professional exams and we will follow SOPs and blah blah blah, and this will see the Cambridge students did not want it to appear in the exam. On the contrary, the ACCA students, they really want to appear in the exam. That makes a huge difference. The Cambridge students were begging and bragging and crying that exam should be cancelled. On the contrary, all of us, we the ACCA students, would like to have a go at in the June. We don't wish to waste our time. Agreed. So that puts government in a different perspective. Anything else? Okay, Abdul Rafa bin Imtiaz is asking a very important question. Can you highlight the most important knowledge-based areas? Yes, I will highlight the most important knowledge base areas in the WhatsApp group. Don't worry. At the end of the webinar, at the end of all the webinars. Abdul Rafa, I expressed this thing yesterday as well, that I will try to extend my support in the WhatsApp group even after or at the end of the webinar or after the webinars around your exam. So I will share a file or something which will help you guys in preparing your knowledge base. So I will share a file, a ready-made file of the knowledge base in the WhatsApp group. Moreover, I will help you in with respect to those MTQs, the selective MTQs. I will share that file in the WhatsApp group. Don't worry. Okay, I think that's it for now. Let's start the last topic for today, and that is corporate governance, another minor topic. Let's straight away go to the requirement. Describe 2 corporate governance weaknesses faced by the Sexophone enterprise company. Okay, what does describe means? I've already told you, describe means half mark is for identification of weakness and half mark is for explanation, and provide a recommendation to address each weakness to ensure compliance with corporate governance principles. So you have to identify and explain few corporate governance deficiencies, and then you have to recommend or overcome those deficiencies as well. Let's read the question. And with the help of this question, I will make you understand this topic. S company has been trading for 15 years selling insurance and has recently become a listed company. Once a company becomes a listed company, the best practices of corporate governance are more aggressively applied on it. S company is required to comply with corporate governance principles in order to maintain its listed status. That's what I was saying. If you want to maintain your listed status, you need to ensure that corporate governance best principles are being followed. And the finance director has undertaken a review of whether or not the company complies. So the review has been undertaken by the finance director. Okay, fine. That one, what happens next? Bill Basen is the chair of Sexaphone. Until last year, he was the chief executive. Now, please read that sentence again. Mr. Bill is the chairman of the company, comma, until last year, he was the chief executive. Now, the chairman has to be an independent individual. The chairman has to be an independent non-executive director. Now, considering Mr. Bill was the chief executive until last year, he cannot be considered as an independent non-executive director now. His independence would be compromised because being a non-executive director now, he was the executive director till the last year. In fact, he was the chief executive. Who is the chief executive? Chief executive is the most senior person among the executive directors. And who is the chairperson? He's the most senior person among the non-executive directors. So here is a deficiency. How do I identify it? I would say Bill Basen is now the chairman. And until last year, he was the chief executive. Full stop. Considering the fact that chairman has to be an independent non-executive director, Bill Basen cannot occupy this position because previously he was the chief executive of the same company. So these two roles are extremely important and they carry significant responsibilities. So you cannot hand over too much power in the hands of one individual called Mr. Bill. So what should be the recommendation? I think Mr. Bill should go back to his original position of chief executive, and we need to hire a new independent non-executive director for the role of chief executive. You cannot say that Bill Basen should continue with the role of non-executive director because he was the ex-chief executive. So if you want to continue with Bill Basen, you have to resume him for the role of chief executive, and you need to have a new individual for the role of chairman. Is this clear? Let's see what the solution has to offer. Mr. Bill is now the chairman after having been the chief executive until last year. You have to copy it from the question. Now, what's the explanation? The chairman must be an independent NED and hence cannot have previously been involved in the chief executive of the same company. The role of the chairman and the chief executive are both very important and carry significant responsibilities. So too much power resides in the hands of one individual. What's the recommendation? Bill Basen should return to his role of chief executive in order to fill the current vacancy of independent non-executive director. Advertisement should be, placed, and a new individual should be hired for this place. Let's continue with the question. Bill is unsure if S company needs more non-executive directors as there are currently 3 non-executive directors out of 8 board members. So Bill Basen, the board comprises 5 executives and only 3 non-executives. This is not in accordance with the best practices of corporate governance. There should be a balance of executive and non-executive directors so that non-executive directors can constructively challenge the executive directors. There should be a balance between non-executive directors and executive directors so that non-executive directors can pursue the best interests of all the stakeholders of the company. What should be the recommendation? At least half of the board, excluding the chairman, should be non-executive directors. And if this is the case, we need to hire at least 2 more non-executive directors in order to make sure the board is in the balance. Is this clear? Let's see what the solution has to offer. The board comprises 5 executives and only 3 non-executive directors. This is from the question. There should be an appropriate balance of executive and non-executive so that the non-executive director can constructively challenge the decisions taken by the executive. or they can defend the best interests of the stakeholders. What should be the recommendation? At least half of the board, excluding the chairman, should be non-executive directors. And if that is the case, at least two new non-executive directors should be hired. Okay, let's continue. He is considering appointing one of his close friends. Mr. Bill is considering appointing one of his close friend who is a retired chief executive of a manufacturing company as a non-executive director. So Mr. Bill is considering appointing his close friend as a non-executive director. The friend has experience of running manufacturing company. On the other hand, this is a insurance-based company. So that close friend might not be independent enough. Moreover, he might not be having industry expertise. So he might not be able to add value to the board of directors. What should be the recommendation? I think we need to hire an independent non-executive director on the basis of skills and experience rather than on the basis of friendship. So an open advertisement should be placed, and on the merit, a suitable person should be hired. Mr. Bill is considering appointing his close friend as a non-executive director. The friend has experience of running a manufacturing company. If this director is close friend of Bill, he won't be able to exercise independent judgment. He won't be able to constructively challenge the decisions taken by Mr. Bill Basin. So what should be the recommendation? I think we need to hire an independent non-executive director on the basis of experience and skill, and there should be an advertisement, and on the basis of merit, one non-executive director should be hired with having relevant expertise for the industry. The finance director, Jessia Oboy, decides on the amount of remuneration each director is paid. This is another deficiency. The finance director is involved in setting the remuneration. This is not right, because according to the best practices of corporate governance, no executive director should be involved in setting his pay. The remuneration should be established by the remuneration committee, and in the remuneration committee, there should be no executive director. The remuneration committee should be made up of all non-executive directors. Currently, all remuneration is in the form of annual bonuses based on profits. Jesse is considering setting up an audit committee. So let's check out the solution. The remuneration for director is set by Jesse, the finance director. No director should be involved in setting their own pay, as this may result in excessive levels of pay being set. The board should establish the formal and transparent procedures for developing and policy for executive director's remuneration. The remuneration committee should determine the amount, and no executive director should be involved in it. All directors' remuneration is in the form of annual bonus. Pay should motivate the directors to focus on the long-term growth of the business. Annual targets can encourage short-term strategies rather than maximizing shareholder wealth. So if the bonus is based on their annual profits, this could lead the managers to, you know, short-termism. They might be focusing on short-term targets rather than long-term goals. Okay, let's finish this question. Jesse is considering setting up an audit committee but has not undertaken this task yet, as she is very busy. A new sales director was appointed 9 months ago. He has yet to undertake his board training, as this is normally provided by chief executive, and this role is currently vacant. So the new sales director was not appointed with the training. Was appointed 9 months ago but has not undertaken training, and this could lead to decisions taken by the sales director which are not in the best interest of the company. Moreover, the company does not currently have audit committee, and in the absence of audit committee, the relationship with the external auditor might not be not be on the good side. Without an audit committee, there is no oversight of the financial reporting process. What should be the recommendation? Company should establish an audit committee as soon as possible, considering the cost versus benefit analysis. Okay, the last paragraph. There are large number of shareholders, and therefore the directors believe that it is impracticable and too costly to hold an annual general meeting of shareholders. Instead, the board has suggested sending out financial statements and any voting resolutions by email. Shareholders can then vote on resolutions via email. No, this is not correct. For a listed company, the company needs to hold an annual general meeting. This is mandatory. That's the last deficiency we have. As company is not planning to hold AGM because that will be too costly. This is all copied from the question. However, the AGM is important, and if this is not, however, the AGM is an important meeting and that gives the shareholders an opportunity to raise their concerns and receives an answers and vote on important issues. What should be the recommendation? The company should continue to hold AGM, sending information by email in advance of the meeting may be practical and save some cost. So they should share the information in advance, but the AGM needs to happen. AGM needs to be conducted. That's it. That was the question called Saxophone Enterprise, and it's a question on corporate governance. Any question for now? Okay, what are the basic roles of NEDs? NEDs, non-executive directors, have to make sure that executive directors are guiding and taking the decisions of the company in the best interest of all the stakeholders. Non-executive directors, see, you have to imagine a map in your mind. So there are board of directors. More than 50% should be non-executive directors and less than 50% should be executive directors. Now, executive directors are going to run the company. The sales director, the purchasing director, the production director, admin director, HR director, finance director, they all will be executive directors. What about non-executive directors? Non-executive directors are going to evaluate the decisions taken by the executive directors. They are going to make sure that executive directors are not making any wrong decisions or they are not pursuing any unnecessary risk. That's the role of non-executive directors. Yes, non-executive directors have some additional roles, such as they tend to make up the audit committee. Or no, the remuneration committee is also made up of non-executive directors. These are the additional roles. Kabir, if you are going to attempt this question and practice this one, you will be good. You will be, you know, well prepared for corporate governance. All the key points are available in this particular question. Barbara, no, you are not supposed to do that because the columns will already be there in your exam. So the column will be like heading weakness recommendation, like that. Weakness recommendation. You have to make sure that you identify the weakness and explain it in the same column. Okay, Mr. Hassan is asking what knowledge-based things we need to learn from corporate governance. You need to learn the differentiation between the executive directors and non-executive directors, the role of certain committees such as risk committee, remuneration committee, audit committee. And I think this particular question helps you in great deal. If you are going to prepare this question, you will be prepared for majority of things. Is there any eligibility criteria for non-executive directors? Not a defined eligibility criteria, but definitely the non-executive director has to be someone very experienced, seasoned, old peer, someone who has got the experience of that relevant industry. And he should be independent as well. No financial interest in the company. Shamshir, there is no such limit to it. The limits are always applied on the engagement partner. So there is no particular limit regarding the role of the chairman or the role of the executive directors. Company law does not say that. Anything else? Any other question, please post your question if there is any. Dear students, please concentrate. If you want to make sure that you end up scoring maximum marks, full marks in the internal control question of your exam, this internal control question and this risk question, they either come as a 30 mark or a 20 marker. So if you want to make sure that you score full marks in the internal controls, you have to follow this. Comet Publishing and Caterpillar, one and third, we did today. Number two, Amberjack and Raspberry are extremely important questions on sales and payroll system. You must solve these two questions after watching the day two of the previous webinar. So I will provide the link of the day two lecture in the WhatsApp group, and you must go through the whole lecture of the internal controls for the day two so that you are fully comfortable and fully prepared. Is this clear? Any other question? Can an executive hold several executive positions? Yeah, and there is a possibility that you are production director and a purchasing director as well. So you are holding two executive positions. But a non-executive director cannot hold any executive or any operational responsibility. Sir, what attempt is this question from? This is from an old format question. This question is available in your Kaplan kit. If you are not having Kaplan kit, I can share the Kaplan kit in the group as well. In the knowledge-based question, should we also need to consider OECD principles? No, you don't have to. Just read them once, but you don't have to learn them. Can the chairman and chief executive be for a short-term basis? That is not recommended because they need time to settle into their role and then play a positive role for their company. So short-term basis, not really. Sir, if part A, the question is knowledge-based question, will there be space given to answer that question on first? All parts of the question are going to be there, then afterwards space. For each and every part, there is a separate platform and a separate space. Abdul Ahad, is this clear? I will show you the ACCA practice platform on the fifth day, the last day. Okay, Danish, I will share the book and the kit in the WhatsApp group right after, at the end of the class. Within no time. Suresh, all the notes are available to you, and with the passage of time, I will share each and everything, whatever you want to. Don't worry. Okay, anything else? Can we have the pocket notes as well? You don't need any pocket notes, trust me on that. Forget about the pocket notes. The most useless thing on the planet Earth is pocket notes. You need to have few things in mind. How to identify the deficiency, how to explain it, how to identify an audit risk, how to explain it, how to identify key control, how to explain it. That's it. You don't need any pocket notes. Okay, Mr. Akbar has asked a very important question. Sir, there was a question of 5 mark from audit report in the last exam. When will you cover that particular topic? When I was conducting the March 2021 webinar, I expressed that particular thing to each and everyone, to all the students, that there will be 5 marks available on the impact on the audit report. I covered that particular thing on the day 4 and slightly on the day 5 as well. More importantly, I focused on that 5 marks on the day 4. Similarly, that particular thing will come up in your exam in the June attempt as well. Mark my words, there will be 5 marks for the impact on audit report, and I will be covering that particular 5 marks on day 4. Is this okay? Okay, very good question from Rana. And sir, could you provide us with a study plan? Yes, I can provide you with a study plan on the day 5. Not today. I can provide you with a study plan on day 5. Is it a mandatory requirement for a listed company to have an internal audit department? This is the best practice of corporate governance, not a mandatory requirement. Country to country, it does vary though. Okay, guys, any other question? Okay, I think that's it. Tomorrow, let me express tomorrow's agenda. The most difficult topic in the syllabus of audit and assurance is called substantive procedure. I am going to start substantive procedure. I'll be very slow, very patient, very slowly and steadily I will build up the knowledge. I have dedicated 2 complete days on substantive procedures. Day 3 and day 4. As far as day 4 is concerned, yes, I'll be allocating half an hour for that impact on audit report 5 marks, which Mr. Akbar was referring earlier. So as far as day 3 and day 4 is concerned, 90% of our time will be focused on the most important thing of this syllabus, which is called substantive procedure. My dear students, if you are comfortable with audit risk, if you are comfortable with internal controls, all you need is to be attentive in the next 2 days. By the way, if you are not attentive or present tomorrow, you are allowed to have an absence on day after tomorrow as well, because next 2 classes are highly interconnected. If you are present tomorrow, you will enjoy everything. So if there is any other question, please ask. Otherwise, it's time I should take your leave, and we'll continue the class tomorrow with substantive procedures. I will add and everything in the group, don't worry. And I will add you all, and I will share the notes as well. Sir, specifically substantive procedures related to payroll and revenue are much complicated. I will start substantive procedures tomorrow from revenue, because you have expressed your point of view. I will share, don't worry. I will share the best questions to be practiced as well at the end of the 5th day. As for now, check this out. For internal controls, I'm recommending at least these 4 questions, but I will recommend 2-3 more at the end of the webinar on the 5th day. So and for the risk, for the risk, at least these 4. I will recommend couple more. So at least these 4 plus 4, 8 questions are your, you know, you can, and obviously you, in order to grasp these questions, you need to cover the previous webinar as well. That's it. I think no more questions. Thank you very much. In the risk question, if we just copy and paste the identified risk, would it be correct? Yes, but then you have to add value. Then you have to express which financial statement understated, overstated. You have to cover that as well. Copy pasting is allowed. I will share a video in which that copy pasting thing will be demonstrated to you in the WhatsApp group. Thank you very much.